So we're going to do the call to worship. I'll read non-bold, you read bold. If you're able to stand with me this morning, let's stand as we do this. With mighty mountains and crashing seas.
Praise the name of the Lord.
With rolling valleys and lush forests.
Praise the name of our God.
With tiny ants and majestic eagles.
Praise the name of the Lord.
With innocent children and wise elders. Sorry, but tiny ants just threw me there. Joy to the world is what we're going to start with this morning. Have anything you want to share that God's done in your life this week? Go ahead, Suzanne.
After 12 years, I got my whole house painted sky blue. I think I'm in heaven.
And you got a washer, too.
And I got a washing machine. Wow. Washing clothes in the sink.
Not yet. It's got to be hooked up first. Wait. Don't jump the gun. It's got to be hooked up first. Okay? You might get home and you have to wash everything by hand. And then you go, see? So be careful. Anybody, anything else? Get Amanda. And we are so glad to have you, kid. Amen. So, amen. So, especially with all you've been through for the last couple of years. So, amen. So, I saw hands over here too. Again, Mike.
Praise God for bringing us all together again.
Amen. Amen. Get an answer.
I'd like to thank my sons, my two sons, for making our Christmas season so special for Frank and me. I thank them.
Did you decorate Frank with tinsel and a? You can hang them off one of the branches, okay? Anybody, anything else? Kid. That is a praise. So anybody else? Anybody, anything else? Yeah, Liz.
I have a lot of praises to them.
You only get two.
Okay. My two grandsons are decided to, not the right shirt that I wanted, but
down in Texas? Mm-hmm. In Texas?
No, the one in North Jersey.
Oh, okay. Okay. Because Texas doesn't have a lot of Catholic churches, having lived there. So it's interesting that you found a Catholic church in West Texas. Forget.
But they're struggling over there, which church to go. They did find a Catholic church. And Tyler is going to stay with Mom. And he said, thank God, because he's going to finally go to church in a year and a half. And he said he found a church. So Mom and Tyler are struggling to which one they're going to go. I think Tyler's going to win.
Okay. And you had other praise? Amen.
So,
amen.
Yeah,
anything else?
And Mark is doing extremely well.
Good. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. So, anybody? Okay.
I just want to thank God. I have a nice little helper today. Mm-hmm. He's helping me out yeah. here.
This is, thank you, Emily. So, and then, yeah, Dan. Amen. Amen. Okay. So, okay. And then I saw... Yeah. Are you trying to top Liz now? Is that what you're trying to top Liz? Go ahead.
I was glad to be home from the hospital.
Amen. And we're glad that you're doing good, yes.
Hope I'm good for another year.
Amen. She said she's glad to be home from the hospital. So, okay. Yeah, Laura.
I'm just asking for prayer. I'm filing my complaint on Tuesday.
Okay. We can definitely do that. Okay. I have a friend of mine who's been in the hospital for, if some of you have gotten the prayer request earlier. Marilyn went into the hospital before Christmas, and we were told that she would probably get home Christmas Day, but it hasn't happened. They're trying to regulate her blood sugar, and they really don't know right now exactly how long it's going to take to do what they've got to do. So I just pray for her. Her and Jerry were very close friends of ours in Texas, and really incredible friends. I mean, they went over and above to help us when we were down there. And their kids are like our kids. So it's just, we just want to keep Marilyn in prayer too. So we'll pray right now for both them. And again,
sorry, Todd, one of my very close friends got a mass on her tumor.
Name?
Jen.
Okay, so you got it. Okay, dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in the precious name of your Son, Jesus, Lord. Lord, you are a God that not only hears us, but Lord, that you move and you move in power. And Lord, we just come upon you right now. And Lord, we ask that these things that are on our hearts, Lord, we pray for Laura. We pray that you would just guide and direct, that your wisdom, your power, that your favor would go before. And that, Lord, as they prepare and all these things are taking place, that there would be a sense of peace and just be with her, guide her and direct her. Lord, we pray for Jen as well for this mass, that, Lord, you would just help her. And Lord, give the doctors the wisdom, discernment to be able to address it and treat it the way they need to be able to treat it. And then, Lord, I pray for Marilyn. I just pray that, Lord, that she'd be able to be home for New Year's, that, Lord, you just let her get out today, that if that be the case, the doctors be able to do what they need to do and help her just so that she can be home and enjoy being out of the hospital after being there through Christmas. And so we just ask all these things, Lord. And then other requests that may not be mentioned, Lord, we put them at your feet because you're a God that not only answers prayer, but you, Lord, you say that when two or more are gathered, you're here in our midst. And we just thank you for that, that your presence is here this morning, and we give you praise for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to sing our next hymn this morning. It's going to, Oh Come, Oh Come, and May. What? Okay, so she's asking for prayer for her two daughters for joy and for health. So we'll do that real fast. Dear Heavenly Father, we just pray for Kim and Terry, Lord, that you would just give them joy and health, that you would be with them, watch over them, protect them, but also, Lord, speak into their hearts, both of them, especially about knowing you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, O come, Emmanuel. So. Amen. You guys can take your seats this morning. I'm going to share. We were talking, John Collins and I were talking after Christmas Eve service in Crab's Claw, and I really would like to do this next year. And what we were talking about was getting our two churches together and doing some Christmas caroling here on the island. We tried it the first year we were here, okay? So I will tell you this. It's hard to find houses that have people in them, which was a problem, okay? But I really would like to try and do that next year, if that's the case, where we get together and do it maybe on a Sunday after church or a Saturday, whatever, and just go out and sing. Because I know people like hymns, and O Come, Emmanuel has turned out over the years to be one of my favorite hymns that we sing. I just think the message of it is so powerful. There's just something about it always seems to speak to my heart, especially that last line when you talk about the idea of peace. You know, we're at a point in our country where our turmoil over politics and all kinds of other things has gotten so great that it almost feels like we're not at peace. You know, and one thing that God promises, Christ promises us, is peace. And so I wish as a nation we would turn back to who God is and have that peace instead of all these other things that we fight over. So that said, this morning we're going to take our offering. If I can have our ushers come forward. Musical ushers, is that what this morning? Would you please rise? Oh, God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Guys can take your seats. So we are looking, actually we're going to kind of rehash chapter 10 a little bit and finish chapter 10. So I titled this, John is Given a Munchie, okay? So, and I guarantee that you've probably never seen this in a church before, this title. And the reason why is because when we're looking at this chapter, something interesting happens here with the little scroll. And so we're going to talk about that. But and Dave even texted me last night to say, are you sure you want to do chapter 10? And I said, yes. I said, we only got to verse 7 before we took the break for Christmas. And I said, I want to get the last four verses, but I want to kind of rehash some of the things that we looked at. The interesting thing is we're almost halfway through Revelation. And as we get through this book, one of the things it's been hard is I'm a person who likes to be upbeat, okay? I like to smile, I like to laugh, all that stuff. And I went to a church when I was a kid, and the pastor was a nice guy, but he didn't smile very much, okay, or laugh. And I started laughing as soon as Suzanne came. The first person came in the door this morning was Suzanne. And she tells me something, and I've been laughing about that ever since she told me about it. And I think the thing is this, is that God wants us to have a sense of joy. And so often Christians don't have joy. They're always looking at the negative things and the things that are beating them down. But as a Christian, you should have a smile on your face. Because no matter what, you know where you're going, right? You know that no matter what happens to you today, ultimately, you know where you're headed, right? And that's the thing, is that, you know what? You know, it's funny, Jeff came up to me and he was talking to me. He went to somebody's 60th birthday party. That was mine. He didn't remember. But as he was, he didn't remember. I had to tell him that was mine, Jeff. Because, and so, but he was saying he got, I know, but he got sick. He got sick a little bit after my birthday party. And he was saying, you know, he was saying, and I'm saying, but that was my birthday you went to. He goes, oh, yeah. So, but what happens is, you know, I turned 60, and I'm like, you know what? It's interesting. So some people last night were saying this. Well, you look pretty good for 60. I'm like, I don't know what pretty good for 60 is supposed to look like, okay? I really don't. But I will say this, is that if you don't smile, it makes you look old, right? Like, you should enjoy what God's blessed you with. You know, if all you have left is today, man, enjoy it. God gave you the blessing of being able to wake up today and take in the air and breathe and enjoy this. Even when I was walking over the trees, I was looking at the trees, and there's no leaves on them, and the little buds are sitting there waiting for spring, right? They're sitting there waiting for spring. Like, those buds on the trees are sitting there waiting, okay? And as I was looking at them, I'm thinking, isn't that what we are as Christians? We're waiting for Jesus' return so that we can blossom into all that we're supposed to be. We're supposed to blossom while we're here, but there's something beautiful about when spring hits and all those things are starting to open up, right? Yes. And all I could think of was, you know what? Spring's coming, right? Spring's coming. Every year I look forward to spring because I hate the winter. I hate snow. I know some of you, Diane Kinley used to always say, oh, I love snow. And I used to say, I hate it. Yeah, she moves to Florida. St. Augustine, Florida, right? To tell me how much she loves snow, okay? She used to say all the time, I love snow. I'm like, yeah. But she's down there and realize, I hate shoveling it, okay? And my mom used to...
I don't see an app for that.
I don't either, Siri. I don't see an app for shoveling. I agree wholeheartedly, right? Siri doesn't even want to shovel snow, okay? But sometimes things just work out really good, don't they? And I think as we look at this morning with John, I think the thing I really want to point out here is we're at a turning point here because we're just before the seventh trumpet is supposed to sound. And before that trumpet sounds, time is short, and we're going to point it out in the scripture as we look at it. But even today, our time's short, right? Every one of us only have a limited period of time. You don't know whether you've got tomorrow or not. You know you've got today. So why worry about tomorrow? That's what Jesus says. Why worry about tomorrow when you have today, right? Enjoy today. Enjoy your loved ones. You know, last night at the wedding, we got up and danced at one of the songs. And Krista's with her back and her knees anymore. Can't dance as much. But we got up and danced a little bit. And just looking at her, I remember thinking, you know, how beautiful she is now. But even the day that she walked down the aisle when I married her. And I told people this. I did. I had tears in my eyes. I saw her with her dad standing at the end of the church, and I thought to myself, you know what? I'm so blessed because this is the person I prayed for when I was a little kid to marry, okay? And so this is that person, and here she is. Now, I haven't been perfect, okay? Krista might tell you otherwise, but... Right, Krista? You might say otherwise, right? Notice she didn't volunteer and go, wait a minute, let me tell you. No, okay, so. But as you look at this, and we look at what we're going to look at this morning, I really want you to see something that, as Christians, what God really wants us to realize is that he's got better things in store for us. And what we're looking at here is the judgment of the world that's rejected God. See, we're with Christ, okay? We're witnessing this from the perspective of heaven. And so as we're seeing this, this is why we as Christians should share our faith with other people, because time is short. And so you get here and you look at chapter 10. It says, then I saw another powerful angel descending from heaven, wrapped in a cloud with a rainbow over his head, and his face shined like the sun, and his legs were like pillars of fire. And you get this picture, this angel. Now, we know it's not Christ. I talked about this couple weeks ago when we were talking about this, but this angel who comes down, and he's got these he just looks incredibly fearsome, right? And we know that the legs, that pillar of fire, is judgment, that he's setting his feet down. And we're going to look at the next verse where his feet are planted, but he plants his feet. And so God is saying, you know what, judgment's happening now. This judgment's going to take place. And for as much as the world doesn't want to believe there's judgment, there is judgment. See, no matter, you know, you might be able to get by with driving down 35 at 60 miles an hour, right? You might, yeah. Right? But when you get caught, what happens? You come up with all kinds of excuses, right? Right? I mean, I guarantee you that you're thinking of excuses as soon as the police officer walks up to the car, right? You're thinking, like, you know, I was in a hurry. I have to pee. I never forget one time I was riding down to see my mom, okay, and they have that little yellow hatch thing before you make the turn, and you're not supposed to ride over that. Well, I was like, you know what? And a police officer pulled me over, and I had to pee. That's really why I was in a hurry to get home. And the traffic was so long, and I said to the police officer, I really have to pee. Can you write the ticket fast and let me go? He goes, no, I can't write it fast. You're going to have to wait. I said, can I at least run across the street to the places over there and go pee? No, you can't. I'm like, okay, can you hurry up? You know? And I'm sitting in the car counting, doing whatever you can. And I remember thinking, you know what? If I just would have taken a little bit more time, I'd be home peeing now, right? Who would have thought my sermon would have turned to pee? There we go. So all that said, you look at this, and you've got judgment that's going to take place. Verse 2, he says here, he says, he held in his hand a little scroll that was open, and he put his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. You know, everywhere else in Revelation, it's always land first, sea second. But this time you see sea, right? And it's going to be mentioned three times in this chapter that he's got his foot on the sea and then on the land, right? And it's the thing that you're seeing here is that judgment's going to happen, but there's power, that God has power over both the sea and the land. Jesus walked on water, right? Yes. Think about it. Have you ever tried to walk on water? Try to run on water? Does it work? No. So there's something, when you see this, he's standing there, there's God's judgment is going to take place, and this angel's saying, it's ready to take place. But that little scroll, what's that little scroll? I'm going to ask you, what's that little scroll? Because you see this little scroll, and that little scroll, there's got to be something in it, right? We'll see in a minute. But think about it, what's that little scroll? Like, you can guess it might be things you're told, but what is it? We'll take a look at this, and I'm going to ask you, what is that little scroll? Because guess what John's going to munch on? Yeah, John's munchie is going to be the scroll, okay? So think about this. I want you to think about this for a second. Now, verse 3. Get to verse 3, and it says, then he shouted in a loud voice like a roaring lion. And when he shouted, the seven thunders sounded their voices. So we know that lion roaring is associated with Christ. So the voice of Christ is not only speaking here, but the angels are speaking through it. And so you hear these seven thunder voices. And John hears this. He hears what they're saying. He hears the judgment is going to take place. But he doesn't know if he can talk about it yet. Okay? So you've got God moving in power. See, time's short. We're seeing this. That small little book, we know. When we first started, right, we started with the big seals and scroll and all those things. But now we went from big to small, right? So small means we don't have a lot of time. Time's short. Okay? The other thing is, this angel set down both on land and sea, so the final judgment's going to happen. See, we're right before the seventh trumpet. Once the seventh trumpet hits, boom, it's really, it takes off. Because you're going to have the seventh trumpet, and you're going to have basically the bowls or the vials. There's seven vials that take place, and we're going to go through those fast. But right now, we have that little interlude. As we're looking at this interlude, what happens is God is speaking, and John gets to hear this. Now, I wonder what he's saying, okay? Now, it goes to verse 4. When the seven thunders spoke, I was preparing to write, but just then I heard a voice from heaven say, seal up what the seven thunders have spoken, do not write it down. So judgment's going to take place here, but guess what? We don't know what's going to happen. Imagine Hollywood writing this up, right? Imagine how Hollywood write this. I kept thinking about this week. How would Hollywood write, if you think about it, like now you've got this next judgment where the angels are talking about what's going to take place, and John can't write about it. Anybody ever told you a secret that you can't tell other people? Right? I like the laugh back there. Gina, I'm not going to tell you any secrets. From that tells me that she can't keep it secret, right? She's off. You're awful keeping secrets, right? But what happens is when you're given a secret and somebody says, this is between us, right? Right? Well, Krista can tell you, there's a lot of stuff that when I talk to people, she doesn't know. Some people assume that I tell her everything. I can tell you I don't, okay? Because there's some things that when I'm talking to a person in the church, that's between me and them. That's it, okay, and not her. And I think the interesting thing here is that when John's told this, he says, don't write, right? Don't write it down. Now realize, right? Don't you want to tell somebody? I mean, imagine all this is taking place. We know he's on the Isle of Patmos. We know that he's probably been tar and feathered at one point, right? And he's picked these things off, and he has this vision, and this vision is given to him, and he sees what's taking place, and he hears the seven thunders, and he sees these things, and he, so far he's written almost everything else, right? But this one he can't write. You ever read a book where the ending isn't satisfying? Right? This is one of those things where, come on, just tell me a little bit, right? Just give me a nudge. Well, as we go further into Revelation, I think some of this is going to be revealed. But I can't guarantee you it is. Okay? So, you get to verse 5. Verse 5 says, then the angel I saw standing on the sea and the land raised his right hand, okay, to heaven. So he's swearing an oath, right? So we know this angel isn't God. We know it's not Christ. We know it's an angel because he's swearing only to a higher power. Who's a higher power? Only God, right? And so you've got this situation where judgment's going to take place. He's keeping the oath of God. He's keeping the judgment of God. And time's short. And he swore by the one who lives forever and ever. Who's that? Who lives forever and ever? Yes, but who's particular are we talking about here? Jesus, right? Remember, Revelation is about who? Jesus. So he's talking about Christ, one who lives forever, who created heaven is what and what is in it. We know that from Colossians chapter 1, verse 15 and 16. Who created everything? Who put everything into place? Jesus did. Okay? Be specific, Jesus. Okay? Each have their place. You have God the Father, you have the Son, Holy Spirit. We know that Jesus spoke these things into existence. We see that. Even in Genesis, we saw that the God the Father was there, but also we see that the Holy Spirit moved over the surface of the earth, right? So, and Colossians tells us Jesus is the one to put these things into place. And it says here, the earth and what is in it, and the sea that is what is in it. There will be no more delay. This is what I preached on a couple weeks ago. Time's up, right? Time's up. Realize something. He's telling the world who hasn't trusted in God, time is up. It's very limited. There is a short period of time. It is going to take off. And as you look at this, realize something. God has given the world time and time again the opportunity to turn back to Christ, right? Yes. He wants people to love and turn to Jesus. That's all he wants, right? Yep. And what happens? We saw earlier in chapter 9, even though all these things were happening, they refused to turn to God, right? So now he's saying, time's up. Because the seventh trumpet is about to sound. And see, things are really going to take off here because we're going to look next week at the two witnesses. And these two witnesses that come along, they're going to preach testimony and they're going to call down fire from God. And there are going to be all kinds of things that are going to take place. I can't imagine, to this day, I can't imagine what this is going to look like on TV. Right? I mean, think about this. What we didn't have back in Jesus' day and back in the time of John was you didn't have TV and you didn't have cameras and you didn't have recordings, right? Imagine when this stuff starts to play out. I mean, think about the way that you'll have access to this almost instantly. Because it amazes me now what takes place in the world, and people are filming it. People have their cameras out, and they're filming. I mean, just think about some of the stuff we see now. And it says, there will be no more delay. Now we get to verse 7. Verse 7 says, But in the days when the seventh angel is about to blow his trumpet, the mystery of God is completed, just as he was proclaiming to his servants the prophets. So we talked about this a little bit last week. What's this mystery, right? What's this mystery? What is the one thing the scripture talks about with mystery? What do we get at about mystery? What did the prophets know? What things took place here? Why now? He said, look, the mystery of God is completed. And realize, what's he talking about? He's talking about salvation through Jesus Christ. Okay, that Christ not only died on the cross, but he rose again, but also he's coming back to establish his kingdom, right? So what you have is this picture here is that, you know what, when that trump is about to blow, time's really up because this is going to accelerate it away where you're not going to have a lot of time to make decisions, okay? And God's still going to have his witnesses there. He's still going to have the 144,000 preaching the gospel. He's going to have all these things taking place, and people still aren't going to turn to God. Anybody here ever do any type of construction work? Okay, so if you've done construction work, you ever bang your thumb when you were trying to hammer something? Huh? Okay, so I did construction for a number of years. Look, Jess is still black and blue. So you try not to do that, right? And so you learn to move your thumb out of the way, unlike Jeff, right? Okay, so when you hammer, right? Like I used to do drywall, I could hammer a nail in one shot, okay? So when you just move your fingers out of the way really fast, and that's how you do it, you just do it. But when you catch your thumb, it really hurts, right? So we try to avoid things that we know we can avoid. Why in humanity don't we try to avoid this, that we know this is going to happen? And humanity knows that God's judgment is coming. You know how they know? It's because as kids, we know right and wrong. Do we not? We know when we do something. Like, we expect to be punished when we don't do what's right, right? Yeah. I mean, even as a kid, I always talked about this. My mom would say, wait until your father gets home, right? Oh, man. And my dad would come home, and then you'd be hiding in the closet because you're like, you know what? Maybe he'll forget. Maybe she'll forget. Okay? And the interesting thing is, you know judgment. Just from being a kid, you know judgment's going to happen. You know those things are going to take place. We know there's a right and wrong. And God is righteous. He's not going to let wrong prevail. And see, Satan has had authority. And we get in chapter 12, and we start talking about all this stuff with Satan, right? There's going to be a battle. Like, we haven't even gotten to chapter 12. When we get to chapter 12, there's going to be a war going on with Satan. Okay? Realize, Satan's not at war right now. You got that? As you're looking at this picture, this isn't a war. This is just the stuff that's happening because of Trump. We haven't gotten to the war yet. And I don't know about you, but if you've ever watched war, it's not glorious. You know, when we're kids, you always got the idea, oh, maybe it would be great to be this warrior, right? But warriors, it's not fun to be in battle. And people don't talk about post-traumatic stress disorders, do they? Right? Think about the things that you go through. One of the things that really stuck out to me was my uncle was overseas, and when they dropped the bomb on Japan, they were just off the coast. And he watched it, and he lost his sight for a week. Okay? And for the rest of his life, he had narrow vision. He could not see peripherally. Okay? And we don't even talk about all that stuff. But he told me that it was one of the most traumatic things he ever went through. Okay? And you think about this. We don't understand what battle's really like, because the battles that we fight sometimes, you know, we're here on this here and we're fighting over, well, I didn't get my Christmas present, or I didn't like what I had on the menu, right? But realize, a real battle is when you're fighting spiritually with something that is beyond your control. And one of the things that's happening here is this is spiritual warfare. And God said, I've revealed the mystery to my prophets. See, over the Old Testament, when you read the Old Testament, you see that Jesus is supposed to come, okay? That the one who was predestined to come when he came at Christmas and all the things we look at, when we look at that, he was destined to come to save us. And you go, well, okay. But the prophets knew this, and they wrote it in the scriptures. But the Israelites still missed it, right? We saw with Herod when we talked about Christmas. What did Herod do? Did he go and rush after the wise men to see what happened? No, he said, if you find them, let me know, right? That was the prophets. And the scribes all looked it up for Herod and said, here it is. And Herod still said, okay, right? Now you get to verse 8. This is the fun part, okay? Then a voice I heard from heaven began to speak to me again. Go and take the open scroll in the hand of the angel who's standing on the sea and the land. So this is another reference, right? Judgment's going to take place. Take the scroll. What's in this little scroll? What's in this little book? What's in this thing, right? What could be in this little book? I think the thing that the more and more I looked at this, and he's going to talk about how it tastes, okay? And it's interesting because he's going to talk about how it tastes, that in your mouth it tastes sweet, but in the stomach it becomes bitter, okay? And I had a friend of mine one time tell me that's what Mexican food's like. In your mouth it's very sweet, but in your stomach, especially when you go to pass it, it's bitter, okay? He said, you know, and I laughed, like, you know, it's a joke, but it reminded me of this when I was thinking this morning. you know, here's this judgment going to take place. So you get to verse 9, and this is what verse 9 says. Verse 9 goes on and says, so I went to the angel, and I asked him to give me the little scroll, and he said to me, take the scroll and eat it. It will make your stomach bitter, but it will be sweet as honey in your mouth. Okay? So why? Why is this little scroll? What is this scroll? What is contained in this scroll? Well, one, you could say, well, he talked about the prophets and what the prophets talked about, right? Which is salvation. But I don't know if that's the case here, because the more I thought about the gospel, and maybe this is the Bible or the gospel itself, is that I have a hard time. One of the guys that I went to school with, he was saying that the reason he thinks it's bitter is because that when you first accept salvation, it's sweet, it tastes good and everything, but your life still has to deal with your sin, okay? And I was like, yeah. The more I think about this thing is, I think this book contains sins, the people. And if you look at chapter 9, verses 20 and 21, and he talks about the various sins and the things, I think that's what this is about, because sin is like that. Isn't sin sweet when people first get into it? Like, and you know, it could be anything, whether it's alcohol, whatever it may be. All those things, it tastes really sweet, but once it settles, right, what happens? It's bitter, right? See, and people get sickened by it and all those things. I think this is really contains the sins. The reason it's open is because our sins to God are what? An open book. See, we think we can hide them, right? We think we can hide every single thing in our lives from people, but we can't hide it from God. No matter what we do, God knows every little detail, right? And so as you see this, it shows, you know, he eat it. And John's going to eat it. And yeah, first it tastes, oh, sweet. But then it gets in your stomach. Right? I don't know. Anybody ever had Mexican food? I love Mexican food, okay? I love hot stuff. But hot stuff you got to be careful with, right? Right? I mean, I like habanero peppers. I like jalapenos. I mean, man, when it comes to habaneros, Christy can tell you, when we first moved to Texas, I hated hot food, okay? I hated all that stuff. And living in Texas, because we lived in Texas, and we had to put up with the cowboys, but we lived in Texas, okay? We lived in Texas, and when our friends always wanted to go to Mexican restaurants, so we went, and the longer I lived there, the more I liked the hot food, more and more and more, and got to the point where I could eat the hottest of hot stuff and not have a problem with it, okay? But man, your stomach feels it. When you eat the hot stuff, I don't care who you are, your stomach still feels it, right? And that's what this reminds me of. He hit it so much on the mark when he said, it's so sweet in your mouth. Like, it can taste good in your mouth, but boy, man, when it gets in your stomach, it can have that bitter feeling. So you get a sense of this, that John feels this, and I think that's what sin is. I think when you look at it, sin tastes so sweet when you first start to take part in it, but once you're in it for a while, it makes you almost sick to your stomach. And you're looking for an answer. And that's what God is. And I think as this is all taking place, that the people should see that's what their sin's done to them. But they rather live with the bitterness in their stomach than turn to God. Verse 10. So I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and I ate it. And it did taste sweet as honey in my mouth. See, it tasted good. See, this is John's little munchie, right? See, I just think this, when I thought about this, isn't that like when you eat something and you have that little munchie, like you just want, okay. And John, I wonder how John looked at this. You know, he says eat it. So John takes it, right? And he's going to eat this. And he's going to, does he eat and savor it? Or does he like eat it real fast and swallow it? See, that's up to you, right? This is interpretation up to you. This is something I'm throwing out to you. Think about this for a second. How would you eat it? Will you try and savor it for a while or eat it? Especially knowing what the effect is once you swallow it, right? Right? See, it's interesting because we don't always think about that. When we eat certain things, it's funny when at birthday party for Jesus, Rick and I were talking about chocolate cake. I always talk about chocolate cake. I like chocolate cake, chocolate mousse cake, all this. And one of the things is that, you know what? I do like chocolate cake, right? And chocolate cake is one of those things. But I like vanilla cake too, just so you know. I like chocolate cake. I like vanilla cake. I like most cake, okay? So unless it's coconut cake, right? Other than that, I'm just not a coconut. My Brazilian people used to make this, especially for my birthday sometimes, they make me coconut cake, and I wouldn't eat it. And they go, why don't you eat it? Because I don't like coconut, okay? So I literally scraped all the pieces of coconut off the cake to eat it, okay? So Krista loves coconut, yeah. But anyway, see, I'm off topic again. So you've got this. We're almost done, okay? So you've got this. I just want you to think about this for a second. John eats this scroll, right? And he's got to decide, does he eat it fast? Does he eat it slow? The angel doesn't tell him, hey, take your time with this, does he? He just tells him to eat it, right? And he's obedient to God. And the symbol here that you see is those who believe in God, obey God, right? Those who don't, live with the bitterness. And so then you get to the final verse in chapter 10. Verse 11 says, then he told me, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. That's why I believe the book probably contains sin. Because what does the angel tell John to do? Share the gospel. You got that? Tell people of every tribe, nation, people that, you know what? You must tell them again, okay? Tell them about the prophecy. What's the prophecy? We saw it earlier. That Jesus Christ came. He died on the cross for our sins, right? That he's risen from the dead, but he also is going to be king. And so he said, say it to the nations, to the people, all the languages. Go tell people about Jesus because the time is up, okay? And then we're going to move into chapter 11. We're going to see the two prophets are going to come along. Those two witnesses, those two prophets come along. They're going to have a nice little battle. Okay? We're getting into some cool stuff now. Like, we went through all the stuff, but what we're moving into next is going to be some fun stuff because we're going to have Hollywood movie type of stuff taking place here. Okay? You know, you talk about fighting and war and all that stuff, that's all going to take place here. But see, as you walk out of here this morning, what's God saying to you about chapter 10? You need to share your faith, right? That you as a believer, right, when you walk out of here, you got to share your faith. You need to tell people about Christ because time is short. You don't know what's going to happen. I can't guarantee that every one of us is going to be here next week. I can't guarantee that every one of us is going to be here tomorrow, right? So make today, see, and you don't know who's going to call you. It could be somebody important, right? So, and Suzanne, you dropped the glove. So you can answer in here. We can listen. As a wedding yesterday, I told everybody, if your phone rings during the wedding, I'm going to answer your phone, okay? So people are, like, turning it off. That's it. So you walk out of here this morning, remember what? Share your faith with Christ. But also, rejoice, right? You are blessed. Every single one of us walking out here knows that where we're headed, right? See, I don't even have to worry about the GPS because guess who's going to make sure I get there? Yep. Jesus is going to make sure I get there. I don't have to worry. Look, I've had GPS mess up before, right? But the one thing I know is that he's going to make sure I get there because he said, where I am, right, you'll be. He says, I've gone to prepare a place for you. Think about it. He's made a great place. And the place we went yesterday was nice. You know what? The Maui Picture Inn is nice. They have this long deck that goes out to where the bay, the ocean, river, whatever it is there. And you walk out there and you see it and you're like, this is so cool. I walked to the end and nobody else was out there and the ducks were all down the water. As soon as they saw me, they all started taking off. And I go, rah, 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 rah. And I'm thinking, okay, I ruined the duck's day because nobody else is out here, but I'm out there, right? And I thought, but this is so cool. You know what? We get to see all kinds of things, but even as grand as some of this stuff looks, it's still not even close to what God's prepared for us. So you should have joy. I don't care how bad things are in your life. This is not all there is. You've got so much more than this. Share it with somebody else. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, what a great and awesome God you are. Lord, we thank you for the power of your word, all that you've given us, all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we thank you that, Lord, this really is the last week that we get to this look at the Christmas decorations in the church until next year. But we thank you so much, Lord. I pray for this new year that each person here would just have the heart to want to serve you, share you, Lord, love you, just be around you, have everything about you in their lives, that, Lord, they can rejoice and have a smile on their face. Because, Lord, we know this isn't all we have. We have so much more in you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to ask you to stand this morning and sing with me. We're going to sing How Great Thou Art. Oh, Lord. How great thou art, how great thou art. So as we close this morning, remember, turn to somebody and tell them this is going to be a great new year of Christ, okay? So have the opportunity. Also, we have some stuff in the back. You're welcome to join us for that. Have a happy new year. Lord willing, I will see you next week. But if Jesus comes back, I'll see you in heaven, okay? So that said, dear Heavenly Father, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory, we thank you for all the blessings, Lord, we thank you that this has been a year that, Lord, we've seen things up and down, but we know our God hasn't changed, and we give you praise for that, Lord. May this coming year be one that, Lord, we are blessed incredibly, but, Lord, we also to share the joy that you've given us. We ask this all in Jesus' precious name, amen. Please take the poinsettias home, okay? So...